Continuing with our 2024 lead, I'll be heading to Milwaukee this weekend for the Republican National Convention. The big mystery remains, of course, who will Donald Trump choose as his running mate? Beyond that are many questions about what a second Trump term might look like. As CNN's Phil Mattingly reports for us, it's undoubtedly going to bring more conservative judges and possibly some drastic change.
The cornerstone achievement of Donald Trump's first term legacy.
I totally transformed the federal judiciary.
That claim, supporters and opponents alike acknowledge, is not hyperbole. After 234 Trump-selected judicial nominees took seats on the most critical benches across the country, 54 of those reshaped the ideological makeup of the critical federal appeals courts.
You solemnly swear.
And of course, the three who drove a generational shift in the highest court in the land.
Many presidents never get the opportunity to appoint a Supreme Court justice. I had three. They are gone.
But as Trump drives toward a potential second term, one thing is clear. He's just getting started. The two most conservative Supreme Court stalwarts, Justices Clarence Thomas and Samuel Alito, could step aside due to age, clearing the way for Trump and his party to name two more lifetime appointees to the Supreme Court. And for Trump, who relied heavily, almost entirely, on longstanding Republican legal philosophy in his first term, he's now made clear he would push sharply right in a second.
I will once again appoint rock-solid conservative judges to do what they have to do in the mold of Justices Antonin Scalia, Samuel Alito, a great gentleman, and another great gentleman, Clarence Thomas.
Trump more than delivered on his 2016 campaign promises to name conservatives to the courts. His single-term appointments rivaled those of presidents who held office for twice as long as he did. But legal scholars note it's not just the number of Trump appointees, it's who he appointed that has had such a dramatic impact on the judiciary that will resonate for decades.
We like people in their 30s, so they're there for 50 years or 40 years.
Trump's three Supreme Court nominees, all younger than 55 years old when he named them to the bench, meaning his judges could have decades to shape rulings and policy across the country. And the key common denominator amongst all of his picks, rock-rib conservative credentials.
Will you commit to voters tonight that religious liberty will be an absolute litmus test for anyone you appoint, not just to the Supreme Court, but to all courts?
Yes, I would.
That 2016 promise of conservative judicial appointments, especially following the death of Justice Antonin Scalia, helped solidify support for his candidacy from skeptical Republicans.
I, Donald John Trump.
Once in the White House, Trump then relied heavily on the Council of Advisors and outside groups to fill open seats with the help of then-Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell.
You know what my top priority is. I've made it very clear. It's the judiciary.
Working with the Republican-controlled Senate, Trump solidified that 6-3 conservative majority on the Supreme Court. And the result, it's been dramatic, even with Trump no longer in the Oval Office. Roe versus Wade overturned. The EPA and other federal agencies stripped of some regulatory power. And in a case deeply personal to Trump himself, a decision that granted the president near total immunity while in office. Trump also successfully flipped three of the nation's 13 appeals courts to conservative majorities. One of the district court judges he appointed, Eileen Cannon, she's now responsible for overseeing his own criminal trial in Florida. But Trump allies and detractors alike point to a less understood but very clear shift in the makeup of Trump's own appointments over the course of that first term. A shift away from the powerful conservative legal establishment and toward lawyers who embraced a more expansive and at times legally tenuous view of executive power. Now, clear about their intent to seek retribution for Trump's own legal travails, forming the basis that allies plan to set as the bar for nominations and administration lawyers alike.
When this election is over, based on what they've done, I would have every right to go after them.
And Jake, I think a critical point here is one that we've been following across several fronts. As we look towards what a second term would look like, there is an infrastructure, there are people, there is money in place that is really formed around Trump. It'd be so much different than 2016. They relied so heavily on kind of the conservative establishment and where their lawyers thought they should go on their nominations, on their policies, on how they operated. That has now changed. It is now a Trump operation driven by Trump people who have made clear it is not going to be what we used to see from the conservative legal establishment. It's going to be what Trump wants to see in a second term.
So, in other words, in the first term, if Trump had said something like, we should have Liz Cheney go before a military tribunal because she's committed treason, there would be enough lawyers and authority figures there to say that we're not going to do that.
From the White House counsel's office out.
Right.
Everyone would stand in the way.
And in a second Trump term, it would be like, absolutely, sir, we'll do that for you.
I wouldn't want to speculate, but you're certainly not seeing a lot of people who would say they would get in the way of anything he wants to do.
Even if it's a crazy idea like Liz Cheney. Continuing with our 2024 lead in next week's Republican National Convention, let's bring in Tim Alberta and Adam Serwer. They have separate articles in The Atlantic about what might be ahead, and they are two of my favorite young writers. Adam, to you first, since we were just talking about the courts, in your article called Stop Soft Peddling the GOP's Extreme Positions, you say that the idea that the Republicans are softening their stance on abortion, which we have not said, but other media outlets have said, is actually a bait and switch because of what Republicans think the courts will ultimately do. Explain what you mean.
Well, if you read the GOP platform, it's a little confusing, but the position is actually that abortion rights are unconstitutional because fetuses are, from conception, people under the 14th Amendment. That is a position that abortion is actually illegal in all 50 states, not after 15 weeks, not after 6 weeks, but from conception. That's an extreme position. It's the same position that it was in the previous platform. It's not a softened position. Anyone who wrote that that was a softened position was wrong, because they're essentially saying abortion should be illegal everywhere.
There's also this narrative that Donald Trump told people, don't put anything in there about taking away gay rights or anything. I that's not an issue that I want to talk about. And you say there's also similarly no softening when it comes to opposition, opposition to LGBTQ rights, or even opposition to gay marriage. Tell us about that.
There's a strategic silence on those issues. But we had a Trump administration before. We know how it works. He watches TV all day, and then right-wing ideologues run the administration. He has not said that he supports those rights. He simply strategically omitted an attempt to remove them from the platform. But that is not a softening any more than, you know, covering up a crime means you feel bad about committing one.
Tim, we discussed an excerpt from your new Atlantic article here on The Lead yesterday. You write that the Trump campaign's plans could be shaken up if the Democrats ultimately do replace Joe Biden at the top of the ticket. You write, quote, they know their campaign has been engineered in every way, from the voters they target to the viral memes they create to defeat Biden. And privately, they're all but praying that he remains their opponent. My understanding is that the Trump people were happy with how Biden did last night with the press conference because it was just good enough to keep him going as the nominee. What's your take? What do your sources tell you on the Trump campaign?
Yeah, Jake, I mean, they're enjoying every minute of this because they recognize that where Biden is right now is no man's land, not strong enough to put all the doubts to bed once and for all and move forward with a unified party around him, not weak enough to have the sort of family intervention that's necessary with the likes of Obama and Pelosi getting to Jill Biden and bringing the first lady in and saying, we can't do this anymore. So basically, you've got the Democratic Party just trying to live 24 hours at a time right now. And they recognize that they're running out of time. And the Trump folks are deeply invested in keeping Joe Biden as their opponent. They recognize that they have optimized their entire campaign around facing him and only him. And so this is really a best case scenario for them at the moment.
And you quote, Tim, you quote Trump campaign manager Chris LaCivita in the article, quote, LaCivita told me there are probably four true battlegrounds, Arizona, Michigan, Pennsylvania, and Wisconsin. He said the campaign feels confident based on public and private polling, as well as its own internal modeling, that Georgia, Nevada, and North Carolina are moving out of reach for Biden. So it does seem that ultimately it will be a fight, because the Biden people see their best path, and I would argue their only path, Pennsylvania, Michigan, and Wisconsin. It does seem like those three states, and maybe Arizona too, are really where the fight's going to come down.
Yeah, that's right, Jake. And actually, right after I published the story, the Biden campaign circulated an internal memo essentially acknowledging the exact same thing, that really those core Rust Belt states, the three you mentioned, which Trump flipped in 2016 by a combined 77,744 votes between those three states, and then Biden won them back by narrow margins in 2020, that is really the only path for Biden. If he loses any one of those three states, the math becomes very difficult.
And Adam, you write about the Trump campaign targeting young Black and Hispanic men, and you quote one of Trump's allies telling you, for every Karen we lose, referring to white women in the suburbs, we're going to win a Jamal and an Enrique. Tell us more about that.
Well, I think it's fairly clear that the Republican Party or parts of the Republican Party believe that a political strategy of political outreach rooted in misogyny can somehow diversify their voter base. I'm not sure that that's entirely true, but it's very clear that they believe it. And someone like Donald Trump, who has a reputation for that kind of misogyny, can be an appealing figure for people who resent women for one reason or another.
Adam Serwer, Tim Alberta, two of the best political writers around. They write for The Atlantic. Check out their work. Thanks to both of you. Have a good weekend.
Melania Trump will make a rare appearance at next week's Republican National Convention. Not yet clear whether she'll speak or take formal part in the proceedings. As you know, she's been largely absent from her husband's campaign, did not attend his New York criminal trial. Randi Kaye took a look at where she has been in recent months and how her last appearance at the RNC played out.
Are you going to return to the campaign trail with your husband? Stay tuned.
That was Melania Trump in March this year telling reporters to, quote, stay tuned about her return to the campaign trail. Since teasing that possibility, Melania has mostly stayed out of the public eye. She was at Donald Trump's side at Mar-a-Lago in November 2022 when he announced his third bid for the White House, and the former president has been teasing her return for months.
She's a private person, a great person, very confident person, and she loves our country very much. She'll be at the appropriate time, she'll be out there.
While also trying to explain away her absence, as he did on Megyn Kelly's podcast.
She's introspective and she's confident. She doesn't need to be out there.
The only person who decides if and when Melania gets out there is Melania herself. A source close to the former president tells CNN that Melania dictates her own involvement. She is very selective and methodical in what she wants to do and how she presents herself. On Super Tuesday, Melania was out of view while her husband celebrated at their Mar-a-Lago estate.
I want to thank my family for being here.
When the former president was on trial in New York for the hush money case, Melania did not attend, nor did she show up for CNN's presidential debate in Atlanta last month. In recent months, she has appeared at private events, including a fundraiser this month for the Log Cabin Republicans, a conservative LGBTQ group, as well as an April fundraiser alongside her husband at the home of investor John Paulson. At the upcoming convention, it's still unclear if Melania will have any formal speaking role, though she did at the last two Republican national conventions. In 2016, her speech made headlines after it came to light that some lines had been plagiarized from the speech given by Michelle Obama at the 2008 Democratic National Convention.
My parents impressed on me the values that you work hard for what you want in life, that your word is your bond, and you do what you say and keep your promise.
Barack and I were raised with so many of the same values, like you work hard for what you want in life, that your word is your bond, that you do what you say you're gonna do.
Days later, a family friend and staff writer for the Trump Organization took responsibility for the borrowed lines in Melania's speech and apologized. The Trumps rejected her offer to resign. In 2020, the Republican convention was upended due to the COVID-19 pandemic. So Melania Trump delivered her speech from the White House Rose Garden.
My husband's administration will not stop fighting until there is an effective treatment or vaccine available to everyone.
She also spoke about the American dream and the love she says both she and Donald Trump have for this country.
There are no words to describe how honored, humbled, and fortunate I am to serve our nation as your First Lady.
And Randi Kaye joins us now. Has she commented at all about what she may do or RNC?
No, she hasn't commented, and a spokesperson for Melania didn't respond to CNN's request for comment either. But really, Anderson, it's about more than just this upcoming convention. It's really about the next 4 months as this campaign winds down. There are a lot of questions about what her role might be. Is she going to get out there on the campaign trail some more? Is she going to stump for her husband? We just don't know. But we do know that the Trump campaign and Trump's close aides have said that that she is in full support of what her husband is doing. She supports the campaign. She supports what they want to do. She's just been very busy raising their son, Barron.
All right, Randi, thanks very much.
Republican National Convention just 3 days away. Former President Donald Trump has yet to name his running mate, setting up a dramatic finale that could play out on stage in Milwaukee. The former president threw out four names today, adding in Senator Tim Scott, though sources tell us that he seems to have fallen out of contention. But in the ultimate Trump fashion, he is keeping everyone, including those four candidates that you were seeing on screen, guessing.
You have some really, really good candidates and, you know, maybe leaning one way, and that changes sometimes. You know, all of a sudden you see something that you like or you don't like, and you lean a little bit differently. It's like a highly sophisticated version of The Apprentice. Ultimately, it's more of an instinct. You know, you develop an instinct, but I like to know all the facts before the instinct kicks in.
Let's talk about this with New York Times senior political correspondent and CNN political analyst Maggie Haberman. And Maggie, obviously, it wasn't that long ago in 2016 when I think it was 2 days before the convention that Trump announced that he was picking Mike Pence as his running mate. Even then, still wavering after. What are you hearing about where his head is at right now on this?
I think he was actually pretty candid about where his head is, which is that he is keeping his cards fairly close. He is tossing a bunch of names around as he talks. You know, I think the reporting that Tim Scott is not actually on the short list is correct. I think that it is J.D. Vance, Marco Rubio, and Doug Burgum. And look, Donald Trump is a comfort zone and chemistry player. It's part of why he picked Mike Pence. Mike Pence also helped him as a bridge to evangelical voters. He doesn't need that bridge anymore. He really owns the party. The person he has the best chemistry with, according to all of my reporting, is J.D. Vance. Whether he decides that there's something else that he needs in a VP remains to be seen. But, you know, there is a part of him that seems to be enjoying this, and that came through in his voice in that interview.
Well, and of course, the people who aren't enjoying it are the different camps that are set up here between. I mean, we've seen so much reporting come out in the last week or so with stories about all three of these candidates and what Trump may like about them or not like. Everyone is watching Marco Rubio on stage in Miami. I mean, what have you been hearing about what that's been like?
Look, I mean, in terms of how the camps are taking this, I mean, look, you've seen all kinds of reports about, you know, Rupert Murdoch is pushing Doug Burgum, and this person is pushing this one, and this person is pushing that one. There is a lot of jockeying going on, as there always is in Donald Trump's world around personnel, and that's essentially what this comes down to. You know, it is an enormously powerful role. It is a person who will be involved in all kinds of aspects of policy and other matters with Donald Trump, both for the rest of the campaign and if the ticket wins. So there is an immense amount of jockeying. You are correct that there is a lot of anxiety around this. I take Trump at his word that he would like to do this at the convention, since it's Friday night before the convention starts, and you know, he likes ratings, and he likes when most eyes will be on him. He has been, other than his Truth Social feed, Kaitlan, where he has been unleashing a torrent of attacks on Biden and all sorts of other things. In terms of what he's saying in more monitored media, he has been quieter, and he has just been letting the focus be on the Democrats and their chaos. That's going to come to an end when the Republican National Convention starts.
Well, how much of that chaos, though, with Biden has factored into Trump's decision here on the vice president? Because he very clearly does not, from what he's said, doesn't want Biden to drop out. I mean, he's criticized George Clooney for calling on him to drop out. He was critical of others, for Nancy Pelosi, for what she said. And he seemed to say today, also in that interview, that he wishes he could wait until past Monday to name his vice president, but talked about how complicated that gets with the convention rules. I mean, how much of that is weighing on this?
I think that's a big part of it. I mean, it's certainly, you know, the fact that there was this, you know, chaos with the Democrats over the last 2 weeks has allowed him to push his announcement back. And he is aware of that. According to all of my reporting, he has been mindful that he has more time. You know, he likes attention to be on him. He likes, as I just said before, he likes attention to be on what he is doing. But also, I don't think that he has been in any kind of real rush to announce this. To your point, in 2016, you know, he offered the role to Mike Pence and then proceeded to tell Chris Christie he hadn't made up his mind yet, and then went back and forth, and ultimately it was revealed publicly that Pence was the pick, and they had this press conference, and that was that. You know, he seems to be similarly uncertain this time. Even if he isn't actually uncertain, that's how he's behaving.
Am I remembering correctly that Chris Christie found out, like, from Twitter or online or from a text or something? I don't think he even found out from Trump, right?
He did find out from Trump, but before he found out from Trump, he found out from hearing that Pence was being flown into Teterboro. And what happened was Trump said, that's not true. I have no idea what's happening with that. I'm paraphrasing, but I have no idea what's happening with that. Turn on your television. And Trump called into a cable news show and said he hadn't really made up his mind, and held that up as evidence to Christie that it wasn't true. And then, of course, it was true that he had chosen Pence and Pence was coming in. And then Trump called Christie and said, you know, I've chosen Mike Pence. And it was sort of the least confrontational way that he could do it. But Trump likes this kind of thing.
And they will all be in Milwaukee, we are told. Maggie Haberman, thank you for that reporting.
Correct.